Well, thank you very much, Nancy and Keith and Leslie, and it was really great to see so many of you here this morning. Thank you for coming. I want to address mainly goal two, and I want to actually connect back to what my previous two predecessors have already said, as Keith laid the foundation, that I think we have reached tipping points in physical sciences and engineering because of a whole bunch of factors such as the economic competition, et cetera, the decline of manufacturing in the state, that many of our R&D laboratories, especially the industrial laboratories, are almost non-existent. What I was surprised to discover that in the pharmaceutical side, for slightly different reasons, a similar thing had happened. So in fact, if you want to connect the research with the larger innovation enterprise, discovery and innovation and invention which might occur in a research laboratory have to be connected to the larger innovation ecosystem, which necessarily must involve industry. So in fact, this second goal is more directed to actually the three sectors of academia, government, and industry. Nancy's was much more focused on the government academia part, but of course all three are related. And the other main goal of the study was, of course, transdisciplinarity. So one of the things, as Keith mentioned, and transdisciplinarity should be distinguished for interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary, where we're actually looking at a deeper integration between the disciplines. And we thought one way was to actually highlight, and that's our goal. The first, I just want to be sure, because I can't see what is. Correct. Thank you. Was actually to establish one or more grand challenges. Now, we should know that over the last few years, many people have talked about grand challenges. Of course, way back in my own physical sciences field, all the way from the Manhattan and moonshot. But more recently, for example, the National Academy of Engineering had grand challenges for engineering, environmental area through National Research Council and others, and they're enumerated in the thing, and we're not proposing a specific grand challenge, but to think about it in the following way. First of all, it is not just top-down. It is multi-stakeholder, where in fact the working scientists, along with the program officers, et cetera, said these are important things to do. So that's point number one. Second, it needs to be compelling. We all agree that if you think the energy crisis or climate, these are examples which are closer to mine, and obviously in biology and medicine, we can come up with similar ones. And then they need to be, will obviously be reasonably large, because in fact you'll want to bring many disciplines together and sometimes fuse many of the disciplines. So there are many characteristics which we have debated, and engineering has some of these grand challenges, energy, biology, et cetera. And the recent, very recent announcement by President Obama of the BRAIN Initiative is in some senses such a grand challenge. So we're not, so that's, and the really important part is if you have to connect this, we must involve industry along with the funding agency and academia. So if that is the prearching goal you remember, then that's sort of what we would say that is the takeaway from this report. Second, obviously, I personally, having worked in an industrial lab, and worked in a government lab and then in academia, feel very strongly about this interrelationship between science, engineering, and technology, and we have to make these things much more permeable. So we have several recommendations which are specifically apply either to academia or government or industry in this matter, because the decline of research in the industrial laboratories in both the pharmaceutical sector and the physical sciences sector, it is important that at least much more work, such work be done in our universities and, of course, in our national laboratory. And that means some of the way industry funds us, for including for the long term, sometimes, very often, they are not academic investigator generated. Some companies still do that, but that's an important element. Second, in terms of graduate education, which is also referred to before, that it turns out many of the industries, you won't have the right manpower. In our field, semiconductor research, which is they were very prescient. The industry created the semiconductor mainly for graduate education in the Silicon area. And then you have some other recent examples like the energy biosciences, the science of genomics. We looked at many of these. So I think these are steps in the right direction where industry is investing either in the long-term grand challenge problem like biofuels or in developing the human capital, which is so valuable, with the fact that they will be relevant to the future industries to come. Then the whole issue of technology transfer. This is, ever since the Bayh-Dole Act, university departments and universities all created large tech transfer offices, but we actually need to go beyond that. If you look at the history of the money which you get through patenting and licensing, it turns out there usually are a very small number of patents which bring up a lot of the revenue. So we must think of it in a slightly different way, where not that we won't have intellectual property in licensing, but really look of it as a much more important as the knowledge exchange. That's why industry should fund for the longer term work, where sometimes the intellectual property agreements are not the driving force, but rather the knowledge exchange. And that needs to be a change both in academia and industry and how this is perceived. So these culture changes are not easy, but there are some good examples again in that area. And there are many companies who actually do that in a forward-looking way, and much more needs to happen in that area. Then finally, I think we really do want to also break down the barriers, the way things are done, both in the physical sciences and the life sciences. For example, we looked at the Department of Energy and we look at the National Institutes of Health. Nancy already mentioned the issue of the contributory effort penalty, but in fact, this relationship between basic and applied is not at all there in many of these because of the stovepiping which occurs. And recently, in Department of Energy, which I know well, there have been changes like energy innovation hubs, like ARPA-E, which are important steps, in fact, which needed to have been taken already before. And then there's an area of graduate education, which is really important to those in academia. DOE does not fund graduate education the way NSF, because, in fact, the funding agencies and OMB. And so there are all these examples where, in fact, barriers need to be broken, or how the funding occurs. Nancy talked about the facilities. You can get from 3, 4, 5 agencies, but the grants management becomes quite complex, and that is what we are talking about. And then finally, the conflict of interest, again, within, especially in the medical area, but you cannot then have such onerous rules which actually prevent what you really want to do, because ultimately those discoveries need to find their way to industry. So ultimately they have to be managed in the right way, and there are issues both in the universities in the way sometimes it is perceived by the public. So that sort of summarizes the kind of areas we want to, that is really breaking down those barriers between disciplines and having a more intimate relationship there, and also especially between these sectors. The industrial sector really becomes important, especially what has happened in both the physical sciences and the pharmaceutical sciences. So that's sort of our report, and maybe Keith wants to say a word or two, and then maybe we can open up for discussion. Great.